Hello everyone. Am I audible? Not to begin with.
The volume is little bit low.
Okay. What about now?
Yeah, Prajul, you're audible.
Okay. So, hello everyone. Thank you for joining us at our CDSSIG and PG Tech events. Which is a talk on SysCon which we had planned. We basically plan on introducing some of the basic concepts of systems and control and the key to automations and all of the concepts that entail that. As for the session today, it is going to be conducted by two speakers. One of them is Harsh Oza, who is a PhD student in the Department of Systems and Controls of IIT Bombay. He did his M.Tech in Electrical Engineering from IIT Gandhinagar and B.Tech from LDCE Ahmedabad. His current research interest involves multi-agent systems and optimal control. As for our second speaker, Sobhik Das, he's also a PhD student in the Department of Systems and Control Engineering. He received his M.Tech in Controls and Systems Engineering in the IIT Kharagpur branch. His interest lies in estimation theory and optimal and optimization based control. So Harsh and Sobhik, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Prajul, for a kind introduction. So good evening, everyone. Welcome to this introductory talk on systems and control. So today, I and Sobhik will be giving you a brief idea what systems and control is, where you see its application around yourself, a little bit of flavor, what kind of theory goes in controlling any particular aspect or application, and then we'll give you a brief idea what current research is going on. So we would like to make this session interactive. So whenever if you have any question, you can ask directly by unmuting yourself. As well as we would like to ask few questions meanwhile, and we would like if you can answer them. So let me begin. So control is the main subject here of today's talk. So what basically control is? So where do you see control in your everyday life? So let's start interacting. So can you just give me some common examples where you see control in your everyday life? So Prajul, if anything comes in chat, please let me know.
Sure, I'll do that.
Okay, so some obvious things when you say the word control, it comes in mind is robotics. So robots is first and foremost obvious thing that comes in mind. So if you see, the first thing is the Spot by Boston Dynamics. Everybody must have seen it because it's an interesting and amazing thing to look at. It's a dog kind of robot. You give some commands and it will be performing your tasks. The second thing is most widely used thing is two-link manipulator, robotic arm in industry. It is used like to pick up and drop things. One of the more fascinating aspect of robotics in today's era is quad rotors. So you will be seeing a lot of quad rotors or applications in various areas. So basically, in all these applications, what you do is that you are having some desired task. All have to follow that desired task. Let us say if you are you ask the Spot to walk on the line, or this particular robot to follow this particular path. To pick up some object from here and drop it at here, or you want this quad rotor to do some interesting trajectory tracking, that it should be following this spiral path. So all these are basic control problems. So then these are very obvious things, but what are some applications which are not obvious in nature? So just hold on a second. Okay. So portfolio management is one of the interesting application which you may not think immediately when you hear control. So how it applies in portfolio management is basically, if you have some idea about stock market and all, then you have something like risk and reward graph. So in technical and algorithmic trading, what they do is they have a particular risk reward graph and they try to follow this path. So this would be their optimum risk adjusted return path. So this will be their return, and this will be here is the risk. So the best point they try to remain make their portfolio on particular this trajectory. So it is also a new and interesting application. The other application, the current research is going on in this area of your diabetes control, sugar level control. So that let us say you have some reference that 140 is the insulin or sugar level limit. So the current research is like you embed all the sensors and the equipments in the body of a human being, and whenever something comes up, your sugar level goes up, automatically this injection of insulin releases insulin into your body, and your level of sugar is controlled. So you do not need to worry about about taking the measurements every time and applying injections, carrying injections wherever you go. So you have seen this different segments of applications, but still there are some basic things which are common to all. So the term control comes repetitively here. So control is we need to ask ourselves, so what is control, how to generate control, why, what purpose does it serve, then what are various components of a control system. So here you must have seen one important point is a feedback part is there. So wherever you are seeing an insulin level control, as I told in my previous example, that there is a sensor that will measure and give you a feedback that your sugar level is high and you need to inject some insulin in your body. So that's a feedback. So all these terms come up in every applications which I mentioned earlier. So earlier, if you see the trajectory tracking problem of quadrotor, so quadrotor has some sensors inside. So it will monitor the position and the reference you have given, and it will give the feedback to the quadrotor, and it will give the direction. So basic definition is here. But just let me highlight a few points. What are basic thing in control is that you have to work in a, you have to get a desired behavior working with a particular objective in mind, even if there are uncertainties present or some disturbance are present. You need to achieve your objective in a performance efficient way. So that is basically control. So how, so let's get started in controls. So what main objective, as I said, is that you need to replicate a desired behavior. So in all these applications, you have a particular desired behavior. If you start with the first example of the spot, it has to follow a path, or the robot manipulator or UAV, even stock portfolio has to remain on the particular line what I had shown. Also, the insulin level should be remaining below. So all these have the common thing is that they have to follow some desired reference. So this is my reference. So all have to follow this reference. So how do you achieve this reference tracking? So basically, you need to have eyes for it. So you have to see that where actual portion of a particular, let's take example of UAV. So let us say if you have to, you have to be at origin 0-0, but you need to understand that where I am standing currently. So for that, you need to have sensor mechanism. So I'll just demo show the block diagram of a basic control system. So here you have this particular sensing mechanism here. So this is your output of the system. This is your UAV. This is your kind of a feedback measurement system that this will give you position of your UAV. This is your desired trajectory that you need to follow a spiral curve, so or a sinusoidal curve. So this you give by yourself. This is your reference. You measure it against the position measurement and you generate an error signal. Then comes the main part, that is the brain of the system, controller. So you generate a control input for the UAV. The control input is basically generated by this controller, right? So these are basic building blocks of it, of a control system. So here you have seen a basic closed loop control system, but then there are also some open loop control system as well. So just let me remove this annotations. Okay, so I'll just give, start with a benchmark example. So what is basically open loop is like you do not have the eyes. You just need to follow a trajectory. You need to follow a command. So let us say if you are crossing the road, in a closed loop system, you will be having your eyes. You are seeing the traffic and according to the traffic you are working. But in an open loop system, you are given a command, your eyes are closed and you are just told that cross the road and you will be crossing the road. So here is one of the benchmark example used in control theory, that is inverted pendulum case. So this is a pendulum which is governed by some differential equations. So our objective is that we need to place this inverted pendulum in the upright position. So through some control techniques, you arrive solving this particular higher order differential equations. You will come up with a control that if you provide this control, you will reach this position at t tends to infinity, right? But what if there is some error? So let me come back to the road crossing example. So you assume that the road is clear, it's perfect situation. But what if a car suddenly comes up? So similarly, what if suddenly some noise or disturbance comes up? So this would not be helpful. This would not give you a stable performance, right? Yes.
So there was a question in the previous slide.
Okay.
So can you explain what G of S is?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So basically this one, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So in control system, basically one important task is that you start with modeling your system. So this is your given system. So in particular applications, what we have seen is that UAV is your this plant. So this UAV is governed by a particular mathematical model, and this mathematical model if you have heard the Laplace transform term, then it is represented in this block. So a UAV or this two-link robot manipulator or whatever system is there, that is represented by this block G of S. So hope I'm clear.
Yes, and there was one more question. So Teju has asked if you could give a brief idea about the derivation of governing dynamic situations.
Derivation of this one, just this one.
Yeah.
So I'm really not sure about it because this is just benchmark example that we use. So I think Sovik can be helpful because I work more on electrical part of it area. So this is a Sovik, can you come into here?
Okay. Actually, here for normalizing, I'm just taking choosing the mass and the length in such a way that I get a one over here on the first term as well as a one on the second term, and then I'm approximating the nonlinearities so as to get a linear approximation. It's a simplified model of the complex nonlinear differential equation, and we have used this just for the sake of explaining the basic idea of open loop as well as closed loop control.
He was asking about the dynamics, how it is derived. It's just your Newton's law, F equal to ma. That's all. Or maybe you could also, if you don't want force balance equations, you could also use Lagrangian dynamics. Put T minus V. Anything.
Yeah. Sorry. That's why I was blanked out for a second when I saw this. So basically, you come with the dynamics from knowing the system and physics of the system, I think. So a spring mass damper system or for an electrical system, you have Kirchhoff's law. So based on those laws, you can come up with this governing dynamics. I'm sorry, that was very basic thing. I just blanked out. So next part. Yeah, so as I was talking about open loop versus closed loop part, basically closed loop, open loop doesn't give you the feedback what is required, and you are not aware about uncertainties. So it only works well in when the plant is well modeled, the signals which are within range, there are no uncertainties or disturbance, then only open loop system will be working well. So in closed loop system, all these uncertainties are taken into account, and then you can have a good robust control. All these errors will be minimized in a closed loop system. So yeah, I'll come back to the previous question in this particular slide of modeling. So this is spring mass damper system. So from Newton's law, you come up with this dynamic equation. So this is a basic idea what is used in control system. the conventional control uses this Laplace transform matrix, and this is the time domain representation in the second equation if you see. So there are basic two avenues, one is classical control and one is the state so modern control. Modern control basically works in the time domain, and classical control is basically in this frequency domain. So there is a correlation between them that is given by this particular equation. So I think Souvik will take over from here.
Thank you, Harsh. Can I share my own screen if it is possible? Okay. Right. So am I audible, and is my screen visible?
Yes,
you are.
Okay, good. So, right. So now, okay. So let me just answer the question on the modeling part. So I think it's clear. So you get the equation by balancing torque and certain nonlinearities in the form of sine of that angle. And for the sake of simplicity, you could just approximate that sine as a linear function. Right? So it's a simplified model of the equation, that of the differential equation that you could get from balancing the torque. Right. So now that Harsh has described the basic fundamental building blocks of control, it is quite natural to ask what are the possible control problems that you could have, right? So when you say that you're solving a control problem, it generally falls under these four heads, namely stability, tracking, regulation, disturbance reduction, and noise attenuation. So the stability is quite trivial. And for this, I would like to give the example for the inverted pendulum. So there, the system was inherently unstable, and hence the control problem is to generate a control function U such that you stabilize the inverted pendulum in upright position, which is otherwise not possible. Right. So the tracking and regulation for this, the objective is to steer from an initial point to a final point or trajectory. If the final point is zero, it's basically a regulation problem. And if the final point is not a fixed point, but in fact a trajectory, a time-varying trajectory, it's a tracking problem. Disturbance rejection accounts for the case where there is a input or output disturbance, and the problem is to generate a accountable control that will help to mitigate, or that will help to reject this distribution disturbance. And similarly, the noise attenuation. So this noise attenuation comes from several sources. So two popular, like two of the sources could be, there could be some unmodeled dynamics. So in the inverted pendulum case, you see that we have approximated the sine as a linear function. Now that approximation might not reveal some of the important aspect of the overall system. Also, it could also be present in the case of model uncertainty. So for example, if you take the case of an inverted pendulum, it is possible that the mass is varying in a bounded fashion. Then is it possible to generate a control so that you stabilize the inverted pendulum in the upright position in the presence of that changing time varying mass? So these are the four problems in a broader perspective.
What is the difference between disturbance rejection and noise attenuation?
So the thing is that when you talk about disturbance, these are in general low frequency signals. By low frequency, I mean that the frequency or these signals are not varying, are slowly varying with time. And a noise is generally a signal which is unwanted and it varies fast with time. Right. So it contains high frequency components, and on the other hand, disturbance contains low frequency components. Is that okay?
Okay, thank you. Disturbance is something low but useful, but noise is something high frequency unuseful.
No, both of these are unwanted. So for example, you could have that as a disturbance, you could have So let me just go here and here. So you see that in this inverted pendulum case, you see that there is a small term. So when you apply this UT, you are able to asymptotically converges the angle to zero, right? But then it might happen that at certain interval of time, you get a surge of voltage in the actuator. So that is the disturbance. So you see here that this term epsilon with this, this is the indicator function, which is one in the time interval 2 to 3. So you see that if you are giving a step input, then between 2 to 3, there's a certain rise and then there's a fall. So that is a disturbance. Is it
okay?
Clear?
Got it. Yes.
Okay, so let me show you the standard feedback configuration that I'm going to use in the subsequent slide. Well, it is a bit different from what you have seen earlier. So here we see that there are four exogenous inputs in the form of R, DI, D, and N. Here DI represents the input disturbance, D represents the output disturbance, and N represents the noise which is coming in the output, which is getting added in the output. And in addition to that, there are four interesting outputs, which are Y, UP, U, and the error at this position. So when we talk about all those problems and you want to design a controller that will be able to solve all those four problems that I have described here, certainly there come certain trade-offs, design trade-offs and design limitations, and that forms the topic of discussion. So the objective is that how do I achieve the benefits of feedback in the face of uncertainty, and here by uncertainty I mean both the disturbance as well as the noise, and how do you design this K to meet those control objectives. To that end, let me define certain terminologies. So by a loop transfer function, you mean, okay, so suppose you are at this position and you cut the loop here. So on the right, you start from the right and then you move along this loop and you reach to the left of the cut. Then a loop transfer function is basically the transfer function between those two points. And so there are two loop transfer function. If you break the loop at U, so if you break the loop here, you'll get the input loop transfer function. And on the other hand, if you break the loop at this position, you'll get the output loop transfer function. Right. The next is sensitivity. So it characterizes or it quantifies the effect of the closed loop behavior when the plant parameter are varying. So when the plant parameter are varying, how does it going to affect the closed loop, overall closed loop system response? That is quantified by this sensitivity transfer function. So again, we have two sensitivity functions, input sensitivity function, which is the transfer function between DI and UP. So basically, you are talking about the sensitivity or the gain between DI to UP. And the other one is the output sensitivity function, which is the gain between D to Y. So note here that the relation between UP and DI can be characterized by this input sensitivity function, as well as the relation between the output disturbance and the output can be characterized by this output sensitivity function. So intuitively, if you want to reduce the effect of DI on UP, it is natural to say that you want the gain or you want SI to be low at certain frequencies where this DI is significant. And in a similar way, if you want to reduce the effect of the output disturbance on the output, you would like to have the output sensitivity to be very low at certain frequencies where this D is significant, right? And there is another thing called the complementary sensitivity, and that is basically 1 minus the sensitivity, and it can be written in the term in this form, in, by this formula. And one thing to note here that by definition, S plus T is I for every frequency in the spectrum. So as I already defined, a sensitivity transfer function quantifies how much change is reflected in the closed loop with the variation in the parameter of the plant. And as I've said that you want to minimize this SI in order to reduce the effect of DI on UP. But in what frequency you would like to do that? So minimizing the effect of varying parameter or the disturbance, that means you would like to maximize this term here, that is I plus L. In a, you would like to maximize the loop transfer function at certain frequencies where the unwanted signals are present. And this, so if you summarize this, so this is the basically the message that I would like you to take, that this loop transfer function characterizes the performance as well as the stability of the closed loop system. And just by looking at the loop transfer function and shaping it in a certain way, you would be able to achieve all these objectives that I have mentioned at the beginning of my talk. So this particular technique is called loop shaping, and this is very much, this is a very fundamental technique which is used. So whenever you are designing any controller and you are getting a very good response, or you are saying that, you know, my system is behaving in a very desirable way, then what you are doing is that you are kind of shaping the loop in a certain way. So let's see. Right. So now if you consider this block diagram here, you could write these outputs Y, U, P, U, and R in, and the error in terms of this exogenous input signals, as well as the sensitivity and the complementary sensitivity function. So it is just a routine, and I've taken this from this book, and if you want to see the details, you can go there. But the important idea is that what does it tells us, right? So you see that when you write the output function, output signal in terms of the exogenous input and the complementary and the sensitivity, complementary sensitivity as well as the sensitivity, you see that there is a clear relation between the output and, sorry, there's a clear relation between the exogenous unwanted signals D, I, and T and the output. So in order to minimize the effect of DI, it is sufficient to minimize this S naught at some frequency, as I've already told. And in a similar way, in order to minimize this the effect of D, you would like to minimize S naught at those frequencies where this D is significant. And as it turns out, that particular frequency is generally that lies on the lower end of the spectrum. Similarly, if you see that if you want to achieve good tracking performance, then you want that this R minus Y goes to zero asymptotically. And in order to have that, you need to shape the loop or vary the gain of the loop transfer function in a such a way that this output sensitivity and the output complementary sensitivity goes to zero at the frequencies where N and DI are significant. So the same philosophy follows here, and it is quite simple, right? I mean, all you need to do is that you need to tweak the gains at the higher as well as on the lower ends of the frequency spectrum of the loop gain, and there you go. You are able to achieve all the control objectives. So to summarize, good output disturbance at the output requires that you need to have the output loop transfer function to be very high in the ranges where D is significant, as well as the large controller gain K where DI is significant. On a similar note, a good performance at the plant input UP requires that the input loop transfer function goes to infinity in the frequency range where DI is significant. And well, this is something that you do not have, I mean, you do not have any control over, but then it is necessary that the plant gain should be large in the frequency range where D is significant, right? And similarly, good tracking performance in the presence of D requires high output loop gain L naught. And so we conclude that this good feedback loop design, and when you say good, you mean that good disturbance rejection and tracking performance, well, it all boils down to achieving high loop and controller gains in necessary frequency ranges. In a similar way, stability under model uncertainty implies that the output complementary sensitivity is small, or this L naught or the loop gain goes to zero at those frequency where the uncertainty are significant. And similar to what we have seen in case of the disturbance, that this noise are typically a high varying signal, and so it has a high frequency component, right? And there you go. So this figure actually summarizes whatever we have discussed till now. So you see that this line, it represents the loop transfer function, and you would want that this loop transfer function is very, the gain of the loop transfer function is very high at the lower end of the frequencies, and it needs to be very low at the higher end of the frequencies, right? And at the bandwidth of the plant, it should imitate an integrator, which is denoted by 1 by S, where S is the S is the frequency component in order to achieve maximum robustness. But in all doing so, as I've already mentioned earlier, that okay, so let me show you a case. So if you look at this, look at the second equation, here we see that the N falls under the high frequency range, where while the DI falls under the low frequency range. So in order to achieve good tracking, you would certainly need S0 to be very high in the lower end of the frequencies. And in order to attenuate the noise, you will need to have a very low complementary sensitivity at the high frequency range. But can you do it arbitrarily? I mean, can you just increase the gain of the loop transfer function at the lower frequency range as well as the gain or as well as decreases the gain of the loop transfer function at the high frequency range at the same time arbitrarily? Well, you cannot do so. So this is one particular case where there's a trade-off. Well, you see that in order to have good disturbance rejection and tracking, you need the sensitivity to be very low at the lower frequency range, which is here, you see, and it needs to be like, and and you see that there is a peak here, right? So when you arbitrarily decreases when you arbitrarily increases the loop transfer function gain at the lower end, so you will have that this peak will increase in order to conserve the area under this sensitivity function. And if you see the complementary sensitivity, it is just the sensitivity which is inverted in which will be inverted. So a complementary sensitivity will be something which is low at high frequency range, and there also we will have a peak. Now, it may happen that you are arbitrarily increasing the gain at the lower frequency range, and as a result of which this peak is increasing, as well as you are arbitrarily decreasing the loop gain at the higher frequency, and you will also have a similar peak corresponding to the complementary sensitivity. If those peaks coincide with each other and your unwanted signal falls in that region, you will have a tremendous amount of amplification, and that will immediately decreases the overall performance of the system. So you cannot just increase and decrease the loop gains. And as it turns out that there are several other trade-offs. So this method of shaping the loop is very fundamental, and whenever you are designing any controller and you are having a good performance, you are basically doing this implicitly without knowing in a way. So now I would like to pass this to Harsh, and he will continue with the applications. Harsh?
Yes, I can hear you. Yeah. Let me just request the remote control. Or shall I share my screen? Okay. Yeah. So basically, now I will be talking about what are the basic control techniques which control engineers use. So one of the most important and most widely used technique is PID control. So PID control is almost taking 95% of the industrial applications, so where PID control is used. So just to give you a brief idea, so as the PID control has three parts, I'll be giving you an idea what PI and D stands for. Is that P is proportional, I is integral, and D is derivative. But what proportional to, what of integral, etc. So basically what you have heard till now is that you must have understood what is the reference point, or what is your desired objective, what is the measured value, and what is the error. So basically PID controller takes all this into account, that you have your error basically measured with the reference, and you take action according to it. So let me give you an example, that if you need to place your UAV at the origin, but you know that you are a little bit right to it. So the proportional control action will be taking an action that you should be moving to the left side. But now the derivative action says that how fast you should be moving it, so that there is no overshooting it. Let's say you are moving the UAV on the left hand side, but it moves too quickly, then you are again misplaced. So this continuous oscillations occur. To avoid this, derivative part, and also there happens what you call is a steady state error. So there may be some offset, and to remove all this offsets and abnormalities, you need to integrate all these parts, that is proportional, integral, and derivative, and you need to adjust their gains. That is also a challenge in the PID control area, but now it has been widely understood and very well used by the industry. The second technique is the optimal control. So optimal control basically means that you have to give a control which will be optimizing a certain performance measure. So if I give you an example, that a rocket launcher rocket launcher system, if you are looking, and if I say that I want to minimize my fuel consumption, then your performance measure would be your fuel consumption, or and then some certain methods are existing in the literature. You use those well-established theorems, and that will give you a control action, that this much amount of control at this time, if you provide, then your fuel consumption would be minimized. Similarly, minimum path planning or anything you can look at. So another technique is stochastic control. So basically stochastics comes in when you have uncertainties in your system. So I'll go back to stock market example, where you do not know what the future prices of a particular stock will be, and there are a lot of uncertainties. So all these things are modeled with the stochastic theories which are established, and if you are interested in this, I have cited one reference. So it has started since a long time. So if you can see, this particular reference is from 1990s. So this is also one of the interesting area if you are interested in probability theory and all. So this is an interesting area of control. So next is some recent research avenues, some exciting applications that you might be interested in. So one is the swarm robotics. That means you have multiple robots, and they have a common objective. They need to perform a particular task. So if you see in these two figures, so in the first figure, the robots are making a brick structure. and on the right hand side there are UAVs. They are doing the combined task of building a rope bridge. So these are some tasks which multiple robots together have to do. So their objectives should be like they should be incorporating what path they have to follow, what obstacles they have to avoid. So all these challenges they have to go through. One more area is of swarm robotics is in surveillance system. Like if you have to, let us say, monitor gymkhana grounds activity, so you would be launching 4 to 5 UAVs and they will be continuously roaming in some certain trajectory. So you will be having your eyes on each and every point of gymkhana ground. So that is one more area of research that is exciting. Then comes autonomous vehicle platoon. So autonomous vehicle is one thing that that is also one exciting thing, but the research currently is at one more level, that is you are controlling the whole fleet of autonomous vehicles. So there are plenty of challenges in this fleet control. So it starts from the system communication. So there are, so what this picture basically tells you is that you have 4 trucks. So they come from different locations, they meet at a highway and they go to a desired location. And why do you need to do that? So basically when you have a platoon of vehicles, you will be reducing the wind load on the 3 trucks which are driving behind. And it has been shown by some researchers that I would mention the name of Professor Carl Johnson from KTH. So he has done this work and he has shown that energy efficiency or fuel consumption is reduced from 5% to 15%. So that is a significant amount. So main challenges in this area come is that when two vehicles are joining at a meeting point, what should be their acceleration, what should be their safer distance, when there is uphill or downhill, what would be their control part. Then there is another challenge in communication, that how you will maintain communication among all this, as well as the other trucks which are at a different location. So there is a threat of cyber security as well. So a lot of research is actively going on in this area. So one more interesting thing is learning and control. So everybody is talking about artificial intelligence and machine learning every day. So control and learning were seen as little different view if you look at it in a prima facie. So what basically learning is that you give the data input and output and it will give you a model. And control is like there is a model, you give some input and then you will get some output. So those are basically those were seen as a different areas, but now researchers are finding some connections in it and they are establishing good works in this. So just to give you an example, let us say if I have a system of I don't know the system's parameter very well, but I can learn on the go. So what it does is that I have a system, I have a cost function, I need to optimize particular cost. So I'll be optimizing the cost and then I will evaluate whether I am good or not. And then again, I will improve my model. So there the learning comes, and then based on the improved model, I will again regenerate my control command and again I will do this process in iteratively. So here control and learning are meeting each other. So it's very interesting area, and people from different universities are also working in this. So I think this was a brief overview of systems and control for everybody. So I guess, so thank you. These are some references, so which were used. And so if you have any questions, you can ask.
Are you going to share the slide?
Yeah, sure. I will share with Prajwal and Dhananjay. I think they can take over.
Thank you, Harsh and Souvik, for this amazing session. If anybody has any questions, they can directly ask or they can put it on chat. We have recorded this this session, and the slides, they both of them will be shared with you all who had registered for this session.
Okay, so I have one question. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, it could be very simple and stupid question, but I want to ask that what is the difference between input transfer function and output transfer function?
So can you go back?
Yes. Okay. So, well, I think you want to ask what is the difference between input loop transfer function and output loop transfer function. Is it right?
Yeah.
So, suppose here at this point, you cut this wire, and so you have a disconnect. So you have two disconnected parts, right? So let's say you denote the left disconnected part with X and the right with Y. Then you find the transfer function from X to Y, and that is going to give you the input loop transfer function. And if you repeat this this procedure on the output side, you will get the output loop transfer function. So
okay, so that gives the theoretical basis of the concepts. Is there any intuition through which we can understand this?
You see that the reason this divisions are being made, that because we can, this concept that this the concept of loop shaping that I've discussed here can be very well extended to a MIMO setting, right? So in the MIMO setting, every transfer function that I'm calling it as a transfer function is basically a transfer function matrix, right? And when you say that you are talking about the input loop transfer function, it is a matrix, the matrix multiplication of K with P. And similarly, you see, when you talk about the output loop transfer function, it is the multiplication of the matrix P and K. In the CISO setting, both of them are equal, but then in the MIMO setting, well, they are not. An example or a reason, or rather I would say an intuition why these divisions are being made, because you see, when I'm talking about the input disturbance problem, disturbance rejection problem, and when I'm talking about this output disturbance rejection problem, both of these are not the same. And in order to analyze both of these, you need to have the input as well as the output sensitivity function, which basically is coming from the input loop transfer function as well as the output loop transfer function. So this could be a intuition.
Yeah, thanks, Souvik.
So Souvik, I think he also had put in the chat box. So his question was, I think, more basic. He just wanted to understand the intuition of transfer function.
So you see that, just considered this mass spring damper system, and you can actually derive the dynamics of this system, and the dynamics would be represented by this differential equation. Okay, so now you want to capture the frequency domain characteristics of this system. In order to do so, it is necessary that you look at this system from a different perspective, and that perspective is the transfer function representation of this differential equation. So does that answer your question?
Yes.
Thank you. So basically, very in layman's term, transfer function basically gives you, if you give some input, what will be my output? So it gives you a correlation between input and output. So once you establish the transfer function by this mathematical modeling, then whatever you need to do with it, you can do it. So that's basically intuitively correlation of input and output.
Yes, thanks.
Like I had one doubt in the slide, like in the transfer function section, if excess is in the numerator, then wouldn't that cancel with that once in the denominator, because fx is just ms squared that itself, right?
Yeah, that thing. Excess upon fx should be 1 upon ms squared plus bs plus 1.
Yes, rightly pointed out. Thank you.
Okay, yeah, I think I made a mistake. So there will not be any x of s in the denominator. So it is just m x squared plus bs plus 1. Yes, thank you.
Can you once please take to the references wala page? Thank you.
So if there are no questions, then I think we can stop the meeting here. Thank you everyone for joining the session. Thank you Harsh and Souvik for conducting this session. Thank you everyone.
Thank you, Dhananjay. Thank you, Prajwal, for inviting us. And thank you, everyone, for joining.
Dhananjay, can you please end the meeting?
Yeah, I was just thinking, Prajwal started this meeting and I am the host. As soon as I end, will the recording be saved?
I have no idea. Wait, let me see if there is some stop recording option. No, I don't see any. So maybe Prajwal should...
Okay, so I'll ask him. I think he had to go somewhere, so I'll just call him.
Okay.
I won't end unless he comes, so it will be saved to you.
Okay, then should I leave?
Yeah, you can. Thank you, Ashish.
Okay, thanks, Dhananjay. Bye.